Clicking a link is one of the most fundamental interactions on the internet. As a web app developer, you can make that click behave in the following three manners. A new browser tab opens up with a new page, the existing browser tab changes URL and loads up a new page, or the existing page in the browser tab smoothly changes content to match the new URL. In theory, the first two cases should only happen when the user changes context, for example, clicking one of the links of a Google search. And the third case should always happen when the user is within the same website but just needs to see a different part of it. Maybe like when you're browsing a website like Reddit, or when you're using something more dynamic like Google Maps. Gmail was the first app to work in this manner. In the words of their designer Kevin Fox, an important aspect of Gmail's design was that the user always felt like they were on one page, and they were just changing things on that page, rather than navigating to other places. Such applications, which act as if the user is on a single page for the whole time they're experiencing it, is called a single page application. To implement a single page application, or an SPA, one needs to be able to change the URL on the page, be able to dynamically change contents on the page, should not have jarring full page reloads, and be able to copy paste the URL onto another browser tab to see the same content. From all this, it is quite clear that the URL, or the Uniform Resource Locator, is the source of truth for an SPA. The URL is broken down into a number of parts: the protocol, hostname, path name, search parameters, and the hash value. This broken down object is basically called a location object. The actual location object found at window.location has a few more parameters and a few more methods as well. To get the bigger picture, the location of the page is part of the window object. Other entities like history, local storage, performance, and many more parameters are stored in this window object. Every browser tab internally has a browsing context, and the window object is representative of that. Interestingly, every browsing context also has a stack called session history. The browsing context lasts from opening a new browser tab, captures all the activities in the tab, and then ends when the user closes the tab. The session history, in its simplest form, is a stack of all the URLs that a user visited during the lifetime of the browsing context. A developer can change the session history using the following ways. Assign a new value to window.location.hrefs. This adds a new value to the session history stack. Use the window.location.assign to change the URL. This also adds a new value to the stack. The window.location.replace, however, replaces the current head value of the stack. But all of these ways always result in a full page reload. Hence, developers clamored for more access to the session history instance. The Web Hypertext Application Technology Working Group, or the WHATWG, wrote down a specification for the History API when they released HTML5. It was an exciting time for developers, as we all discovered the wonderful window.history push date and window.history replace date APIs. The push date API added a new state to the session history stack, and the replace date API replaced the current state of the stack. But both of these had the wonderful feature that they could change the current URL without causing a full page reload. The next requirement was a way to execute code changes on the change of URL so that pages can be updated. But the WHATWG pretty much ignored that in their spec. But they did provide a way of listening to location changes when the user clicked on back and front buttons on the browser. This was through the window.popstate event. There was also the fact that the different browsers had inconsistencies in their implementation of the History API specification. So, developers did what they usually do and made userland solutions. The first of these was published when Twitter moved its front end to use the pushdate API and wrote a blog post about it. Most of the userland solutions are libraries that wrap around the History API. If we were to make a minimal working History API wrapper, we would create a listeners array, add to it through a listen method. We would create a push method that wrapped over the push state API and called the listeners whenever it was called. Every time we use the library's prescribed methods, we would change the URL, not have a full page load, and be alerted of the changes. One such implementation that you can use as an npm package is history.js. So let's go ahead and use this library to create a small front-end app with client-side routing. We will use Code Sandbox to do this. Open Code Sandbox and pick a vanilla project. Go to the index.html and add a couple of navigation items. Now get into your JavaScript, get all the correct elements from the HTML. Create a browser history object using the history library. This history object is mutable and has to be a singleton throughout your web application. Now create click listeners for navigation buttons. On click of the button, push the URL into the history.push method. You will see that the URL is changing. Now we want to show content on each button click. For about, this will be the content, and for blog, this will be the content. Now let's create a route configuration. This is typically made as per your needs. In this app, I will make an object which contains the path name, the name, and the render method for the route. Now we can use the history.listen to tell us which location the route changed to. When the push from the button happens, this callback function will get called. The callback function will receive the current location object. Now we need to go through our route config and see which route's path name matches the path config. This is the route matching. Usually, a method called matchRoutes is provided by more serious routing solutions. Now that we have a match, let's call the render function and put the results onto the app div. We now somewhat have a functioning routing solution written in plain JavaScript using the history.js library. So the next time you have to use a routing solution, say React Router, Redux First Router, Ember Router, Vue Router, Routify, or any other, remember that underneath all the different abstractions, they are also just pushing and listening to the changing URLs.